Ladies and gentlemen, we are ready to start. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, professors, distinguished guests. I'm very happy to welcome you again tonight here at the Sismanoglio Megaro of the Greek Consulate General in Istanbul. We have tonight the third series of the lectures remembering the Ottoman past in the Eastern Mediterranean, which are co-organized by the National Hellenic Research Foundation of Athens and the Orient-Institut of Istanbul. Tonight it's about photography in the Ottoman period. As you see, we're also surrounded of photographies, which are not actually from the Ottoman period, but quite later, but still an interesting topic as well to see. Tonight I'm particularly honored and very happy to welcome here at the Sismanoglio Megaro, Mrs. Eleni Aguridi, who is senior representative of the Stavros Niarchos Foundations, which I'm sure you all know it's the main contributor and supporter of all the activities here at the Sismanoglio Megaro together with the Bodosakis Foundation. Welcome and thank you very much for attending. I do not want to take the floor for very long. I just ask Mr. Wittmann from the Orient Institute to present today's lectures. Thank you very much and welcome again.
Dear Mrs. Agorinis, dear Consul General of Greece, ladies and gentlemen. After the First World War, at a time when the Ottoman Empire was already in its last years of existence, the highest religious authority of the empire, Sheikhul Islam Mustafa Sabri Effendi, undertook the effort to formulate a legal opinion, a fatwa, on the legitimacy of depicting humans and other animals in possession of a soul by way of photography. Published in the Ceridie Ilmie in 1338 or 1920, we read his, at least for the Sunni Muslim majority, authoritative view on this matter in the classical question-answer fashion of Ottoman fatwas. Here we read, are depictions of humans or other human beings with a soul, other beings with a soul, that were made by a Muslim through the technology of photography in accordance with the Islamic law, the Sharia, or not? The answer is they are forbidden. Is furthermore, the question continues, the display of such pictures in one's home or other localities objectionable on the grounds that they border on the illegal? The answer is yes, they're objectionable and cannot be tolerated. This legal opinion was formulated and made public some 80 years after what has been often considered the official beginning of photography. In 1839, the Frenchman Louis Gardère sold his rights to his special method of post-exposure processing of visual images to France, which revealed the complete working instructions to the world on 19th of August of that year. Just a little over 2 months down the road, the multilingual official Ottoman journal Takvimi Vekayi published in its edition of 19th Shaban 1255, 28th October 1839, a lengthy article explaining in great detail how the chemical processes of the daguerreotypy succeeded in generating a kind of visual images which today we would call photographs. Knowledge of the path-breaking invention of photography became thus available in the Ottoman Empire virtually simultaneously with Paris, the capitals of Europe, and the Western world as a whole. These two poles, the categorical rejection of photography on Islamic religious grounds that we find in the legal opinion of 1920 on the one hand, and the early recognition and notice that the new technology in the production of images enjoyed as soon as in Western Europe, on the other hand, I believe demonstrate clearly the highly complex, fascinating, and at times openly contradictory attitude that one encounters when dealing with photography in the Ottoman world. Over the past decades, scholars in different academic disciplines enlightened us through their studies of a great number of factors that brought about and shaped the complexity of attitudes with which photography has been encountered in the Ottoman Empire. Islamic art historians have demonstrated that the arrival of photography occurred at a time and as part of a process in which visual depictions have become a more prominent part of everyday life by the 19th century. Traditional forms of miniature painting have changed, and illustrations in books have begun to reach a wider audience with the introduction of the printing press among the Muslims in 1727. The so-called tulip era of the 18th century introduced a synthesis of classical Ottoman styles with European Rococo and Baroque styles. European artists have begun to work in greater number at the Sultan's court, and their particular style would soon become popular with the elite and the more general public. Landscape painting and panoramas of Istanbul became popular. The sultans began to commission official portraits that were given as gifts to dignitary and foreign rulers, such as Selim III's portrait, which was given to Napoleon and was soon reprinted in books and popular paintings. Social historians inform us of the rise of secularism during this period, which diminished the undisputed role of religious precepts in setting the norms for people's behavior. At the same time, the Ottoman Empire experiences a rise of the bourgeoisie with a growing interest in current European intellectual debates and the latest technical innovations. From the scholars of Islamic law, we learn of the fine subtleties in the interpretation of religious norms by stressing the need to differentiate between allowed two-dimensional depictions of humans and animals with souls and the forbidden three-dimensional sculptures. The depiction for merely scientific purposes is to be distinguished from the unlawful use of pictures in the religious sphere as illegal idolatry. Ladies and gentlemen, both of our speakers tonight have significantly contributed to the complexity of our understanding of photography in the Ottoman Empire and added to the discourses and debates in their respective academic disciplines. We are more than glad to have Professor Edhem Eldem and Professor Karl Kaser with us here tonight to address from two different angles a particular aspect of photography in the Ottoman realm. This is the importance of producing visual images for the forming of personal memories and in remembering a shared Ottoman past in the capital city, Istanbul, and beyond. Professor Kaser will speak to us on creating memories, photography in the late Ottoman period. He is one of the foremost scholars on Southeastern Europe and has had a keen interest in photography throughout his work. He has come to us from the University of Graz in Austria, where he is professor for Southeast European history and anthropology. He was appointed a full professor in 1996. His major work and research interests have been focusing on historical anthropological fields, such as the history of the family, kinship, and clientelism, as well as gender relations in the Balkans and visual cultures. Among his most recent monographs are Patriarchy After Patriarchy, Gender Relations in Turkey and in the Balkans, 2008, The Balkans and the Near East, Introduction to a Shared History, 2011, and Other Views, Religions and Visual Cultures in the Balkans and the Near East from 2013. In addition to these and numerous other publications, he has made a name for himself through organizing and participating in several major research projects. His ongoing research project from 2012 to 2016 is financed by the European Union and carries the title Politics of Memory and Memory Culture of the Russo-Ottoman War of 1877-78, From Divergence to Dialogue. Our second speaker will hardly need an introduction at all to an Istanbul audience. Edhem Eldem is professor at the Department of History at Boğaziçi University, Istanbul, and has taught as visiting professor at Berkeley, Harvard, at various institutions in Paris, I spare you the many abbreviations, and has been a fellow at the Wissenschaftskolleg zu Berlin. It is our privilege to mention that Professor Eldem is also a member of the advisory board of the Orient-Institut Istanbul and also a member of the academic board of the Istanbul Memories Project, which focuses on the research of Ottoman self-narratives. He has worked on the Levant trade, Ottoman funerary epigraphy, the socio-economic development of Istanbul, the Ottoman bank, archaeology in the Ottoman Empire, and late Ottoman first-person narratives and biographies, most notably Osman Handibey's. He has curated a number of exhibitions on historical subjects and themes, the latest one being, if I'm not mistaken, the fantastic exhibition Camera Ottomana, Photography of Modernity in the Ottoman Empire, 1840 to 1914, which was shown from April to August this year at the Research Center for Anatolian Civilizations of Koç University, just around the corner, and which he jointly curated together with Zeynep Çelik and Bahattin Öztuncay. This exhibition is also the topic of a new monograph, which Professor Eldem published together with Zeynep Çelik. Other publications of his are French Trade in Istanbul in the 18th century, 1999, The Ottoman City Between East and West, Aleppo, Izmir, and Istanbul, with Daniel Goffman and Bruce Masters, 1999, A History of the Ottoman Bank, 1999, Pride and Privilege, A History of Ottoman Orders, Medals, and Decorations, 2004, Death in Istanbul, Death and Its Rituals in Ottoman Islamic Culture, 2005, Consuming the Orient, 2007, Mendel Sebach, Documenting the Imperial Museum, 2014. I would now like to invite Professor Eldem to the stage and to share with us his thoughts on the search for Ottoman vernacular photography.
Apologies for this, and apologies also for the fact that I will not use the local lingua franca, English. I will speak in Turkish. When in Rome, do as the Romans.
Good evening. I am more than pleased and honored to be here with you today. Well, very briefly, I will be talking about how I came to research this subject, because I don't have any photography background, nor am I an historian of photography. It was by an accident, and what, as Dr. Wittmann mentioned in his introductory speech, in the spring, and in spring with Zeynep Çelik and Bahattin Öztuncay, we had the exhibition of Camera Ottomana, and we prepared a monography which would accompany that exhibition bearing the same title, Camera Ottomana. You know, it was the reason why I ended up researching this subject. Well, I'm not a historian of photography, which means that I'm not interested in the photography or the story photography, which other people are doing very well. So daguerreotype, whether it was introduced in the 19th century or not, this is not I'm talking about. Or as a social artist or a social historian and social scientist, I am looking at the mentality and the relationship between the society and the use of this technology. So from a certain perspective, I'm sort of, you know, I'm in conflict with the photography historians in this sense. When I say I'm in a conflict or I'm in disagreement with them, the first aspect is as follows. The collections are harming us, and there are some less idiosyncratic ones, there are less subjective ones. The archive types, which are more neutral, which are the resources that we need to go and utilize. This is what I believe. So when I'm talking about the vernacular, you know, it can't be really translated into Turkish. This is the local dimension that I'm talking about. So looking for the vernacular aspect, this is what I'm trying to find. You know, it was Sabah Abdullah, you know, which you see an example here, reclining women, you know, the chambers, the Orientalist photography. So I think we need to go beyond that. This is what I believe. And I'm not questioning whether that's a legitimate form of study or a form of research, but of course it can continue. But perhaps to a certain extent, everything has been said what could be said. But I'm looking, what I'm curious about is, you know, there is this meta level, which you could call Orientalist, the big studios, major studios, which were positioned on Caddi Kebir, on Beyoğlu Street, produced by these studios. And almost all of them are having this foreign clientele, and they are also delivering to some foreign tastes or audience. What is the vernacular? There is more vernacular taste, smell, a reality, so to say. And there is this agency. I don't know which is the best Turkish equivalent for the agency. But in terms of the agency, who are the local actors? Who are the local players? Because we can see their participation even more in this sort of photography, in this vernacular aspect. Can we peek through that? This is the question, the big question I'm posing. So studio photography, of course, we are going to have them. And the name Seba, Abdullah, so and so forth. Again, we're going to encounter those names. But there is this tourist souvenir or Orientalist portrait. I don't know how to put it exactly. You know, the kind you would see here, as you see on the slide, you know, with which we're very familiar. So rather than this touristic type of photography, more realistic, you know, more connected with the social reality, and even the poser and the user can see the more vernacular aspect. So this is the story of the photography. Is it possible to depict that sort of history? As I've told you before, the reason I have shown you this, because we have hundreds of samples. We know them. We can date back to the past, you know, 18th century, 19th century. But they are so much repeating themselves. You know, we are at a loss of words to say new things about this. If you look at the next one, you know, I actually witnessed a young researcher at a conference, you know, the reclining Orientalist portraits. If they are standing straight, they are real Orientalists, the real Muslim women, you know, so much so that they dare to say that, you know, if the women are standing straight, they are real Muslims. So these are the real portraits. You know, this is the assumption which they have gone to claim. I think there is a serious problem because we do know that they're, you know, they're structured, stereotypical, very conventional, in line with certain conventions, some norms, and between the client and between the photographer, there is full harmony. Who asks for what? There is this full consciousness and awareness. So there is this harmony. So this is the genre that we are talking about. This is a very interesting example. You know, these are the familiar and very famous studio products, Seba, Pera, Abdullah, brother, so and so forth. Another example from Seba, which was very extensively used, widely used, so much so that all throughout the 19th century, when we're talking about 19th century art culture, no one concludes a presentation without ever talking about this picture. So this is Seba and Marie Delaunay, Osman Hamdi, you know, gathered this compilation, which was prepared for general service in 1873. You know, there are a number of clothes, planches, or plants, or the pictures. There were many. So this is Hijaz. In Hijaz and Yemen, this is the planche of Hijaz and Yemen. So these planches were rather, you know, these were more anthropologic, with a certain reality. And actually, we're talking about an empire portrait. This is the purpose that they're serving. You know, the photographs are accepted as serving that purpose. I found them in a special collection. This one, I found that in a very special collection, which is very interesting. Another one by Seba. And if you pay attention, the actors who are in the photography, they're almost they're the same, exactly the same, identical. You can check them actually one by one, and right and left, they're the same. They're the same actors, and that means that Seba actually is a very flexible studio, and you know, using the same materials, if they want, they can have anthropological oriented or Orientalist, just like on the right hand side. This is purely fictional, you know, Bedouin or Arabic lifestyle is depicted, you know, in the photography, as you could see. So they show the fictions by Seba, the photographer, and there is a certain objective, there is a target, and the Europe in the form of weaver, like in the exhibition in 1873, or on the portrait, on the window of Seba, the tourists who notice them and buy them, in the eyes of these people, you know, there is always this expectation, known, familiar type of photography. So, and if we continue, we see that some historians can, Michel Woodward as an example, in some photographs, this Orientalist dimension is taken back, and more realistic or socialist or social realism is more emphasized. Hence, the people in the photograph are not mere objects, or they're not used as models or mannequins, but they are rendered more effective. So some historians talk about such photographs. This might be a good example for that. This is a kebab restaurant, and you know, the kebab seller and his apprentices and the clients, whomever they are staring at the camera. They're staring at the shutter. There is this awareness, there is this agency, sort of dealing with their own lives. And you know, in the following photograph, there is this detail, in a certain detail, the kebab master has a guy standing behind him, even though we can't understand what they are, you know, behind his back. There is a photograph which is attached to the wall. The photograph is very similar to this one, so we can assume that this is not an Orientalist product. Effectively, and as an agent, we can see that the local people, the vernacular people, are contributing. They are internalizing. You know, this is the type of photography. So, when you look at this one, this is rather problematic. This approach is rather problematic because still, I do believe that. Essentially, I believe that such photographs belong to the same genre, produced for the same consumers, you know, the European interested people, European tourists, so to say. So these assumed vernacular people do not actively participate in that generation, in that production. So it's not very convincing. If we're going to give a context to the photography, from time to time, it's sometimes possible to see such authorship or ownership. So these postcards in the collection of Genghis Kahraman are very interesting. Actually, they are typical Dami Turk, like the Turkish Daman. You know, they are wearing the traditional clothes. These are not very Orientalist. I mean, women are not reclining. But at the very end, we can talk about a typical, typical type. The good thing about these postcards is that they have been actually written. And there is writing, which is Turkish at the back. And more interestingly, this was written by a woman. So if we go back, if you pay attention, you know, the women are wearing, you know, there is something written. Nehar, Lütfiye ablam, sister Lütfiye, and someone, blah, blah, sister. So, one Nehar and two sisters. And if we move to the transcription of the text, this is the transcription. This is the content of the text, which is a very interesting text because there is really a woman named Nehar signed by her. She wrote the whole thing. And if you check, you know, the photograph, she's probably writing to someone who she calls sister. If you would like to see the situation, if you would like to remember your situation or when you were back in the palace, I wanted to remind you, dear sister. This is very interesting because she makes a direct reference to the reality, you know, to her. And she's sort of making, you know, semi-comical. So even though this is fake, she was writing to someone, but, you know, in order to make a reference to the past, she believes that this is sort of rather funny, and she adopts this, actually. She internalizes that. Does this make the photography more Orientalist? No, it's not. So only in use, she's writing this to give a message, to attach the meaning, and she has changed it, and she's actually, playing with that. So I think the historian historianship is actually giving you, this historianship is different from the photography historianship, and she gives a context. So there is a receiver, there is a person who writes, and between these two people, this is a fact that this has existed, and it means something. So this is a mere indicator of that. The problem is as follows. As a matter of fact, we're working on the studio photography, especially the majority of these portraits are in line with the European conventions and norms. The habits of Europe, they have been constructed as such. So, which means that the studios in Beyoğlu have not invented anything. Gustave Legrève does something in Paris. Whatever this Derry or Gustave do in Paris, they take this and they try to replicate that in Istanbul. And the people who pose in those studios are pretty much looking for that. What Aziz wants actually is an imperial portrait with the furniture, with the studio outfits. He would like to see that totally, you know, obeying what the photographer tells him, and you know, leaving everything to the skills of the photography. But he participates in that structuring. Yusuf Izzettin, his son, likewise, he is posing, and he's posing in a very conventional, nonchalant, he's sort of indifferent, dreaming, daydreaming, and, you know, his elbow is situated on a book, totally European construction, fashioning the self, could be the term. And we see that the furniture, and I think the book, even the book itself, are the same aspects of Mithat Pasha portrait. These are the services offered by the studio, the photography studio. So the poser, to a certain extent, is passive. He's in a passive mode. And he knows that he is going to receive whatever he is expecting from the photography. He gives himself to the hands of the photographer, and everybody is happy. And hence, this is hence a European portrait. And Wendy Schultz or some other scholars emphasize that in Europe, the transition from picture to photography was rather soft, which means that, you know, the portraits in the paintings and the structuring photographs were rather different, but there was a soft transition from the first to the latter, from the former to the latter. But the same tradition was not existing in the Ottoman photography. For that particular reason, Ottoman photographers had to invent everything from the scratch, just like in Europe, and it was sort of an invented art as they performed it. And it's possible to find portraits which are confirming that this is not an easy task. Abdülkadir, the famous Algerian rebel who rebelled against France, is a rather famous one. This is Abdullah portrait. And the major aspect with this portrait is the books, the set of books on the table. If we have a closer look at the books, which are placed on the table, you might see that they're not books, they're actually monographs. And these monographs, handwritten monographs, are very much in line with the Ottoman and Islamic traditions. There is a paper bearing the label, the title, and unfortunately, only the last one could be read, the fiqh by Suyuti, an Islamic Egyptian scholar, fatwa book by Suyuti, which is very interesting. So in Abdullah brothers, of course, it's very easy to assume that they don't hold actually a Suyuti copy. Abdülkadir on purpose posing just like Jellaba, the whole outfit is emphasizing he's from Algeria, and Le Jour de l'Heure and Mejidi, the signs, the orders are worn to feature his fame and by Suyuti, copy, it is an indicator that he is a scholar. And again, this is from the Ottoman archives. We don't know who that person is, but I think it is possible to identify. This is Ali Suavi, a portrait by Ali Suavi. When he was in exile, it was in Paris, in France. He got that portrait, so definitely this is not an Ottoman portrait. But interestingly enough, if you zoom on the details and check the books, which is very interesting, you can understand that they are not they're alien, they're foreigners, but some papers were stuck onto that, they were glued, and they are rendered as monographs. So probably, you know, this is something like a dictionary, divani, adliye, mehcul belagat, you know, something in Arabic was written, and he glued it to the, onto the books themselves. So Ali Suavi, the poser, had direct intervention to the photograph, and the Islamic rebel or whatever revolution person or whoever, whatever he calls himself. You know, you could see that. And if you look at the prayer bit, you know, he's very much aware of the intervention of the photographer, and he's actually self-constructing his own portrait. This is another piece from Cengiz Kahraman archive, Riyanizade, from the late Şeyhül İslam's. And this is in his home. It's a portrait in his home. We don't have a lot of symbolism here. The roses. But of course, the roses and the monographs are very typical. But what is striking is here is, unlike the studio photography, there is no embellishment, no decoration. There is this actually very simplicity in his garden, taking the his senility portrait, so to say. The person is emphasized much more, therefore the photography is taken less, is given less. The details could be seen as follows. I'm sure you're going to understand it much better. One last example, an anonymous picture, a photograph, which I found in the old booksellers. Probably it was a photograph which was shot in rural region, which is very interesting because it's not a very frequently encountered portrait. A young woman, if you zoom on the details, again accompanied by books. And Kamusu Türkiye, the last one. So, you know, it's important that, you know, you have to have a book portrait on the portrait. And interestingly, she's showing all of her fingers and her earrings. So again, portraying herself, probably prior to a wedding, which is a very interesting portrait, you know, unlike something we see before. And in contradiction, it's very secondary quality, sort of, you know, or less quality. But the woman is very elegant, and she's featuring herself. And all of these point to the agency, rather, you know, the switch from the photographer to the person photograph himself or herself. And this is what I'm talking about. In Europe, we had that famous, the Renaissance elbow, for example. So the Renaissance elbow, and in 15th and 16th, starting from 15th and 16th centuries, this is something you could spot in the photography. Here, this is a Dutch portrait in 17th century portrait. And again, you know, something frequently used and used by Winston Churchill here. So you could see that continuation. And well, we can't see that. Can we see that in the Ottoman Empire? Again, I found a photograph in the Ottoman archives in the Prime Ministry. 1, 2, 3, 4 types like this. You know, this is what I came across. Very interestingly, they all had the same pose. So for the ones who are familiar with Turkish pose, this is not very difficult to find. So it is sort of arms folded, so I'm at your service pose. And I'm at your service pose in the Turkish miniature art is very frequently encountered in the Turkish miniature art. From the very beginning, as this is a very normal respect correct form, and when we see in all forms of miniature art, when we see the emperor and all the other authorities, this is something same. This is from Abdullah Brothers, by the way. But this is not among the high objects of photography. And thank God we have the names. I mean, not the names per se, Hussein Efendi, whatever, you know. They are all in primary, secondary, tertiary civil servants, got the PA. So they're the civil servants, you know. They're not significant people in the, you know, the institutes. And obviously, you know, the emperor told Abdullah Brothers, okay, take a photograph of those guys, and with the same background, with the same curtain, they all gave this, you know, the same pose. And of course, while these guys were portrayed, you know, they were not even only in Renaissance album. No, this is taken for our distinguished high excellency is, and however he wants me to pose, I'm going to pose, so I have to show my respect. So thinking of the receiver, you know, the person, the commissioner here in this respect, the emperor, is actually identifying, you know, he's determining the pose. And these are the examples of from the miniature. You can name them all, and this is not only seen in these public officials, but this is something which you could see in the prisoners. You know, we have pages of prisoners, and they're not mock shots, European espionage types of photography. They are photographies, and which have no function for the police work, which is very interesting actually. And this is one of the highest level of poses. You know, I'm at your service pose. And, you know, of course, if you hear the emperor making a compilation of the photographs of the prisoners, this is how you're going to pose. But we have different poses as well. And when you look at those poses, the same pose, identical pose, is seen by a different guy, featured by a different guy. I can't remember the name, but one of them is Albanian, the other one is Anatolian Greek, and they are having the same pose, featuring the same pose. But this is not, this is the hand on the belly, another hand is on the leg. What does that mean? If we dive into the history, and have a look at the Ottoman tradition. You know, in a conversation, while in a conversation, if you are surrounded by friends, we sort of see such poses are given. I don't know what that particularly means, but at least visually, these poses by these guys, are not imposed by the photographer, nor they are random. So here, as you could see, the form. There's a selection, this agency, these posers are deciding on. And, you know, we can give more examples. And of course, again, when you turn on the pages, we have this, you know, sitting and putting your both hands on your thighs, whatever, the legs, okay. On your legs, the upper legs. Likewise, here, this is repeated, and again, repeatedly, likewise, this is something we see, even in the emperor portraits, the sitting form, shape of, you know, this majesty, sort of silence, peaceful size. I don't know how to put it. You know, it means something. It is a pose as follows. We can have many more examples in this respect. Last but not least, the prayer pose. So, among the prisoners, the prayer concept is very easy to encounter. So, we are praying for you, your excellencies. So, you know, trying to get rid of the current situations through prayers. And in the miniatures, we only see these depictions in the form of funeral or burials, but this is very conventional in a certain continuum, which we see very frequently. And, you know, in order to, while concluding my remarks, This is a very famous picture, the School for the Deaf and Mute. The students and the academic staff posed all together for this photograph. It is seen in the Abdülhamid pictures in Servetüf Yunan. It was published in Servetüf Yunan. And when you look at this photography, you see how body language is important, how important. You see the teachers on both sides, and they are, I'm at your service. They are featuring that I'm at your service pose. They have this obedience body language. Whereas the small kids here, they are prayers, sort of in the form of prayer pose. And with that innocence, they are praying for their emperor, and they are showing how grateful they are. And at the very back, you see the ones who are using sign language, whatever they could say, of course. You know, Padişahım sen çok yaşa, long live the emperor. So they are signing that, and collectively, they know that, they assume that, hoping that the emperor would see that. So, knowingly, they are using their body language with their pose. They are communicating a message through the photography. And of course, there is the group of ones which can't be understood. When I say can't be interpreted or understood, they're not related with the Renaissance elbow. They're sort of more European, especially in the Balkans. There is this heroic pose. If you look at this pose, Garibaldi, very wicked, Calamity Jane, Buffalo Bill, and in the Balkans, in the all of the Bulgarian collections, see, they are positioning themselves as the heroes, the calamity, thugs, or whatever. You know, this is a continuation of that, extension of that tradition. And if we continue, this exhibition is naturally was affiliated with the Jön Turks, who were sort of the young rebels, and Mer Pasha is included in those. And he was using this as a marketing tool. He is the hero of the liberty, and he is always ready for action. So all of these are fed through the European tradition, but on the other hand, we are talking about a vernacular aspect or vernacular tradition, which is extending to the 19th century. So to wrap up, I would like to show you two pictures, which do not exist actually. I would like to talk about those. So both of these pictures are from Istanbul Encyclopedia by Reşat Ekrem. And you know, Istanbul Encyclopedia was randomly published. There is no photography reproduction. Havuzcalı made some pictures, some illustrations. And the real documents were illustrated. One of those real documents was Theodor Vafiadis' photograph by Theodor Vafiadis. Well, creation Petri, the knife guy, he murdered 13 people. He is known as the monster of Galata. Kavas Nikola, you know, he is the thug, and he is the lover of the ambassador of Austria-Hungary. So there are layers of stories. But when you look at the check the text, this is what you see. How Petri was killing Nikola. And Nikola, he was ambushed in tavern, and as you could see here, he found him in the tavern, and Nikola showed their photography to everyone. This is me, and this is Damavri, my putana, my bitch, so to say. And he was exposing it to everyone. So even though you can see the real photography, the original copy, so now this has a very serious history. So this actually depicts the life story and life cycle of this photograph and how that was consumed. Nefer Arif and İsmail Hakkı are together, their portrait together, which seems a very simple photograph. But when you look at the narrative, both lovers who are killing one another, actually, and here, again, we are talking about a different type of text. And in a small photography in Tophane, this one piece was sold for 1 mecidi to the curious people. And this is depicting actually how these photographs were actually sold to the public. And this is sort of a souvenir, a reminiscent of this tragic love story, which ended in death. And, you know, people showed interest in that. So, in conclusion, it's not possible to see this among the collections. Unfortunately, this is not what the collectioners are gathering. They are looking for the rare, unique ones, and this randomness, which is the real essence of the history, is going to the dustbin. And the real way to capture that, to get a real photography archive or stock, and feature some samples. We started to see those. Armen Robosyan worked and published a book on Armenian family. Dil Dilyan, Atelier Photography Studio in Marzifon, and their remaining photographs, which are very different from Sabah or Abdullah Brothers Studios. They had a very powerful and strong vernacular aspect, and we started to see more and more examples. But of course, you know, we also have to acknowledge that in Anatolia, there is a plethora of photography studios and photographs as such, and all of them throughout genocide and throughout the war times, they were all eliminated. So whatever we are left with, the high-level Istanbul Beyoğlu archives, studio archives, and their lovely, decorative, already orientalist or oriented against the other, oriented towards the other nations or the civilizations, the real ones, the vernacular aspect, you know, aspects, probably are the rare ones. Unfortunately, we don't have much information about those. Because of that rarity, we can't have a better idea about the agency, their participation as agencies, and the vernacular aspect. And you know, we are actually in a weak position. Thank you so much.
So good evening, ladies and gentlemen, also from my side. First of all, I have to thank the organizer for this very kind invitation. I did not hesitate 1 second because this invitation brings me back to one of my favorite cities, Istanbul. So my part in this evening is that of the photo historian. And I think the two lectures complement each other in a very perfect way. In our digital age, photography has become a mass phenomenon. Seemingly everybody is using photo cameras, be it in form of a digital camera, be it in form of an analogous camera for the more conservative users, or in form of a mobile phone. Photographic images are documenting important and not so important events in our lives. They depicture the cultures of the world and constitute an important means to construct them. They create proofs in the sense, look, I was here and there, and I was accompanied by these and that friends. Photographs reaffirm family ties and evoke family memories. They can be admired almost everywhere, in daily newspapers, in weekly magazines, on the internet, in the streets, in classrooms and offices. Photographs as well as photo cameras are cheap. They are popular with all age groups and can be operated by men and women. Photography is seemingly universal, but was and is it really universal and universally accessible? I just want to share with you a few observations which let me hesitate to subscribe that universality ceases. Only approximately one decade ago, Saudi Arabia passed a law that officially permitted to take photographs. This was prohibited until 2006. The same country controls the internet, once more, in order to permit access to everything that is offered. Pornography is very prominent on the agenda. If I remember correctly, a few years ago, there was a discussion in Turkey whether the internet should be controlled in order to ensure family-friendly access. In Israel, similar discussions have been taking place. Ultra-Orthodox Jewish believers used to buy mobile telephones without photo function. The harmlessness of cameras is proved by the seal of a rabbi. The final example relates to the fact that only 76 years after the official presentation of the first commercially realizable photo camera in 1839, the first public atelier of a Muslim photographer in Istanbul was opened in Pera, not far from this place in 1915. The owner was Rahmizade Bahedin Bedis. I am very sorry for the bad pronunciation of this name, who had received his training as photographer on the island of Crete and who operated a photo studio in Izmir before he moved to Istanbul. These examples remind us that the creation of images is not unbiased and related to serious theological considerations in the three Abrahamic confessions. These considerations were and are not objected to the creation of visual memory per se, but to the pictorial representation of God, human beings, and animals. The theological dispute on permission or prohibition of photography in the Islamic world, and even in the late Ottoman Empire, was very complex. In my paper, I do not pretending to understand this complexity completely. What I want to do is to shed some light on it in its first section. The second section will point to the fact that the reluctance of the Muslim population to represent itself visually opened up significant space for other agents of the photographic business, internal as well as external ones, to represent the Balkans and the Near East. So I come now to my first section, which is called Pre-Secular Understanding of Images. In the long pre-secular period, which lasted until the 19th century and in some parts of the post-Ottoman space until the interwar period and even until now, pictorial cultures were religiously charged. The population of the empire consisted predominantly of worshippers of the three Abrahamic religions of the book. The Islamic, Jewish, and Christian Orthodox iconic traditions, also having significant differences, shared crucial commonalities. The attitude of the three confessions towards the image was basically formed by the Old Testament's second commandment, which prohibits the production of images with God, human or animal beings in it. So it sounds the following way: thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. Early Christianity was strictly against paintings and statues in churches. The Eastern Church overcame this prohibition of visualization after serious contentions in the so-called iconoclastic controversy in the early Middle Ages. However, the price the defenders of the iconic representation had to pay was a massive limitation of artistic expression. While Orthodoxy elevated the holy icon a sacral status, Judaism remained hostile and Islam at least very skeptical about images. Similarities among the Abrahamic religions in relation to the understanding of images consisted in, firstly, the refusal of three-dimensionality. Its main danger was considered the fact that the plastic figurative representation comes too close to an earthly human being. This was the reason the Ottoman Empire remained free of any figurative monumental art. Istanbul's first public relief sculpture was created only in 1928 on Taksim Square. You all, everybody knows about that relief square. Secondly, another crucial commonality was the rejection of the observer's perspective in Orthodox iconic painting and in Muslim or Jewish book painting. Since approximately 1300 AD, in Western painting, the eye of the painter became the central perspectival point of reference. Thirdly, an additional commonality was that the beginnings of visual culture, understood here as based on the mechanically reproducible image in the Ottoman Empire, were significantly later than in Western countries, where this kind of representation began already the late 14th century. The emerging visual culture among Christian populations of the Ottoman Empire in the 19th century coincided with the distribution of the photographic picture and the beginnings of processes of secularization. Western visual modernity in the form of photography met the traditional pictorial traditions in the Balkans relatively unprepared and could not be linked to each other at the very beginning. How did Islamic authorities react to pictorial representation and emerging photography? I would say pragmatically and contradictory. Let's start with attitudes of Ottoman sultans. There were Ottoman sultans that did not constitute positive examples for good believers. Mehmed II, the conqueror, was the first who commissioned a Venetian painter to portray himself in the second half of the 15th century. Reform Sultan Mahmud II was the first Ottoman Empire who dared to show his portrait to the public centuries later. In 1835, 4 years before the introduction of the photo camera, his portrait was posted in Istanbul's military academy and 1 year later in several army barracks. This act provoked protests, but gradually the population became acquainted with portraits of their sultans. They became more frequent under the rule of his son and successor Abdul Majid I, who was educated in France. His successor and last reform sultan, Abdulaziz, appointed the three Armenian brothers, Abdullah or Abdullahian, to court photographers. He permitted to be photographed by them and ordered the distribution of his official portraits. Being the first sultan moving abroad, he was impressed by public monuments. He commissioned the British sculptor Charles Fuller to create a bust and an equestrian statue. Finished in 1871-72, these two items were transported to Istanbul, but never displayed in the public. His successor, Abdul Hamid II, seized the reform process and tried to reaffirm his role as caliph. He prohibited portraits of himself openly until shortly before the end of his reign in 1909. He mandated the destruction of all photographic glass panes and photographs with his portrait in 1880. On the other hand, he was highly attracted by photography, established his private photo studio and photographic facilities in the Imperial Museum. He was completely aware of the usefulness of photography for propaganda and information. He had thousands of photographs made of the empire and its institutions. Since he rarely left his residence, he used photography as a source of information about important events in his empire. Under his rule, the 911 so-called Yildiz albums, named after the Imperial Yildiz Palace, comprising 36,000 photographs, 36,000 photographs, most of which originated in the 1880s, were collected. They depict the capital city and various aspects of the provinces. Pictures of Istanbul depict quarters, palaces, houses, mosques, churches, hospitals, fabrics, schools, banks, museums, and embassies. Other pictures show landscape, art, objects, sport, scenes, archaeological sites. Next picture. soldiers and civil servants, technical achievements, weapons, trains and ships, but also pictures of the United States, Japan and the Far East were included. These photographs were not shown openly. A special selection of 51 of these albums was presented for propaganda purposes to the British Queen, the French King, and the US American President in 1893-94. Most of the photographs were taken by graduates of the photographical training at the Imperial Academy of Engineering, who were exempt from general restrictions with respect to photography. This pragmatic approach towards photography is also reflected by the permission of the Sharif of Mecca to the Egyptian colonel Mohammed Sadiq Bey to photograph the holy places, the holy sites of Mecca and Medina. Faithful Sadiq Bey could convince the Sharif that his camera would not offend religious decency. The sultans and caliphs' attitudes towards photography were relevant, but not eventually crucial. The opinions of relevant Islamic scholars had also to be taken into consideration. In 1909, Mustafa Sabri, the second last Sheikh Islam of the empire, made a comment to the effect that portrait photography could be tolerated because portraits did not depict the whole human body. However, in 1920, as we already heard in the introduction, the last Sheikhul Islam issued a legal opinion on photography. According to him, it was a sin for a Muslim to paint or photograph human beings and animals. However, additional legal opinions of Islamic scholars have to be taken into account, but I think I will skip this consideration because they are theologically highly interested, but probably too specific. So I will jump to my second section, which is called Agents of the Photographical Business. For non-Muslim permanent citizens and occasional travelers, there were obviously only few restrictions with regard to photography. A decree issued by Sultan Abdul Hamid in November 1900 interdicted the import and distribution of pictures with God's and Mohammed's name in them, pictures of the Kaaba or other objects in Mecca, of religious buildings and of ceremonies and portraits of women. Because of the Muslim reluctance to photograph and being photographed, foreign tourists, non-Muslim foreign and domestic photographers became agents of the photographical business. They created, or better reaffirmed, the already existing exotic and orientalistic of the region. Before we go deeper into this case, a few words about the extent of photographic activities in the Ottoman Empire seem to be appropriate. In the first decades after the introduction of the new pictorial technology, there were only a few local photographers in the Ottoman and post-Ottoman space. In Istanbul, Greeks, Arabic, Christians, and Armenians constituted the most pronounced groups of photographic pioneers. In 1857, the Arabic Christian Pascal Sebach, we already heard about him, opened his photo studio in Pera. 1 year later, the three already mentioned Armenian brothers, Abdullah, started operating their famous studio in Pera too. Generally, almost all photo studios were operated in Pera and not elsewhere in the city. Until 1900, 65 studios, most of them owned by foreigners, were registered. In Greece, there were only 16 professional photographers registered in 1875. Most of them operated their studios in Athens. Germans and Italians dominated the photographic business. In Serbia and Bulgaria, Austrians dominated. In the capital of Serbia, Belgrade, only 9 photo studios existed in 1860s. Among the most prominent domestic photographers in the Balkans, the productive brothers of Vlach origin, Yanaki and Milton Manaki in the Macedonian territories have to be mentioned. They became engaged with photography around the turn of the century. Photo studio Marubi, based in the Albanian city of Shkodra, had almost an exclusive monopoly of photography in North Albania. Pietro Marubi, Catholic by confession, had emigrated from Italy, started working approximately in 1860 and established a dynasty of photographers which left approximately 250,000 negatives. In Sofia, the photographic dynasty of the Karastoyanovi impacted the photo business to a high degree since 1878. In Jerusalem, Yesai Garapedian, who studied photography under supervision of the Abdullah brothers, became Armenian Patriarch of Jerusalem in 1865. He trained a generation of young photographers, among them the famous Garabet Krikorian, who established a wonderful pictorial collection of Jerusalem. 5 years after him, in 1890, Khalil Rath, another Arabic Christian photographer, opened his photo studio in Jerusalem. Besides such indigenous photographers, hundreds of foreigners, travelers, ethnographers, men and women, visited the region in this period of time and shot thousands of photographs. Only to mention the French photographer Philippe Bonfils, who operated a photo studio in Beirut, the Leonard and Landrock photo studio in Cairo, the owners of which were Germans born in Bohemia and Germany. The British women traveler and orientalist Freya Stark, or the British women traveler, historian and archaeologist Gertrude Bell. When the camera was brought to the market, specific images of the Balkans and the Orient were already discursively affirmed. Photographing travelers and on-site Western photographers did not make scruples to take advantage of the Oriental prejudice and to exploit them commercially. They knew that they were what they were looking for, and they found it. My thesis here is that this emerging photographic discourse had at least as equal impact on Western societies as the written works of literates, journalists, and traveling scholars analyzed by Edward Said, or for the Orient, and Maria Todorova, as well as Vesna Goldsworthy for the Balkans. However, the early photographer had more impact on the formation of the concept of Orientalism than on Balkanism, which was due to the fact that the early flows of mass tourism did not touch the Balkans except the archaeological sites of classical Greece. 2 years after the first camera was brought to the market, the British Thomas Cook began to organize boat trips to the Near East, and from 1869 on, his company offered cheap travel packages, which were also affordable for the middle class. He opened up new attractive destinations, the pyramids, the biblical locations, the antique sites of the Aegean Sea, and finally a route through the Marmara Sea to Istanbul. The standard route for the photoshooting traveler included the antique sites of Sicily and South Italy, Athens, possibly Corinth, then Egypt and Syria, the Holy Land, and finally Istanbul. Overhand journeys became feasible when the so-called Orient Express from Paris to Istanbul and back was established in the 1880s. An increasing number of Western tourists filled the hotels and coffee houses of the fancy Istanbul quarter of Pera. The Holy Land, and especially Jerusalem, were top destinations for tourists from the Western Hemisphere. The curiosity for the Holy City was fed by colonial, scholarly, and revitalized biblical studies. The first photographers arrived shortly after the introduction of the photo camera in the Holy Land. It counted of one of the first places in the world where photographs were taken. In the second half of the 19th century, approximately 250 photographers took pictures. 30% of them were French and almost 20% British by origin. Only approximately 5% originated from Germany or Austro-Hungary. Interestingly enough, this kind of Orientalist photography was developed in Western photo studios. Because of the emerging market for that kind of photographs, famous English photographers such as Roger Fenton established well-equipped studios for so-called genre photographs. In his studio in London, the famous photographer of the Crimean War produced a series called Orientalist Suite in 1858. In 51 photos, he imaginatively imitated scenes of Oriental private life. These studio photographs became paradigmatic for studios in the Near East, where this kind of staged photography was imitated. Among the favorite motifs was the water carrier, the dancer, the musician, yeah, the barber, or the vendor. Most of the early photographs and postcards had to be shot in studios. This was related to the still immature photographic technique, on the one hand. On the other hand, female nude photographers could only be created in studios. It was relatively easy to photograph street scenes and landscapes, but difficult to get close-up images of people. The staged studio picture aimed at depicting reality. Photo studios served as theatrical setting for the representation of an anonymous population, which was very often misleadingly categorized according to race, tribe, and class. In many cases, individuals were photographed, the identity of whom remained unresolved. Certain visual clichés emerged. Among tourists, seamen, and soldiers, women's nude photographs in the cheap postcard format was most popular. Among the classics were colorized motifs of the young men from the the young women from the desert, or the young Kabylic woman. Similar to the harem paintings of the pre-photographic era, the real Oriental women was unveiled and lascivious, a challenge for the imagination of the Western men. The difference between paintings and photographs lay in the way they appeared to the viewer. The photograph claimed to represent reality in a way no artist would claim for a painting. The figure of The woman is an erotic and exotic object of the European's gaze is dominated, for instance, by photographs of Leonard and Landrock, already mentioned before, or the domestic Pascal Sebach. The most explicit versions of this eroticism were mostly produced in cities of North Africa and Egypt. They were more rarely seen in Turkey, Lebanon, Iraq, Syria, or Palestine. The real Egypt Fellah woman was not prudish, covering her body completely. On the contrary, the eroticism of the nude consisted in the juxtaposition of closed and unclosed parts of the body with the veil or head covering often remaining as a motif. These photographs, like many Orientalist paintings, constituted a transgression not of Western morality, but of the rules and the taboos of another culture, viewed as inferior to that of Europe. The West constructed its own Orient and its own memories. In order to conclude, it should be emphasized that photography as memory and document was not uncontested among the majority of Muslim and Jewish population of the late Ottoman Empire. Not only that they prefer to establish and reaffirm memories orally, they considered the imitation of concrete persons by artists, photographers, or actors as a sin because this challenged God's monopoly of creation. Therefore, domestic Christians and foreigners took over the lead in the photographic memory business and created a doubtful picture of the Orient. Abdul Hamid's Yildiz albums was a first but rather unsuccessful attempt to of counter speech. The Young Republic of Turkey was more successful in presenting an anti-Orientalist view of the country. However, it could not avoid to commission foreign photographers, among whom was Otmar Pfersi, who was born in the same Austrian region I was born, was one of the most influential. I thank you for your kind attention. And I thank, or many thanks to our interpreters.
Dear friends, dear colleagues, thank you. Thank you very much for your contribution dedicated to photography. Excuse me, I don't have my glasses. Yeah. Thank you again for this contribution dedicated to this fascinating subject called photography and memory. It is well known that it is a very big debate on the photography and memory, that means for the uses of photography writing history. Because the images that mobilize conscience are always linked to a given historical situation. Photograph seems to crystallize sentiment more succinctly and to diffuse it more poignantly. They say that when the passion takes on the form of narrative, it does not vain, but photographs juntas. But permit me also to underline something that Susan Sontag noted. Any photograph has multiple meanings. Indeed, to see something in the form of the photograph is to encounter a potential object of fascination. The ultimate wisdom of the photographic image is to say, there is the surface, now think, or rather feel into it, what is beyond it, what the reality must be like if it looks this way. And now let's open the discussion, the third part of this event. We have some minutes to take your questions, suggestions, comments. Please. No questions? Yeah. Please.
Hi, everyone. I would like to continue in Turkish. First of all, I would like to thank you very much. Both presentations were very impressive. Well, I would like to touch upon something very impressive. In both presentations, I have seen the ancient photographs, especially the studio ones. Interestingly, there were the shadow place, as if they were taken from Karagöz, the Turkish ancient stage dolls. And Esen Bey formed a relationship with the miniatures. Did you have the chance to look into the affiliation with Karagöz place? Because we're talking about memoirs, memories, and their tiny forms of perceptions. And actually, we are constructing this through what we see. So those constructing those portraits in the studios were probably very much influenced by Karagöz depictions, especially the Zenne, the women. They were very much similar to one another, that personality in the Karagöz stage things. It is very probable. It is very probable. Well, of course, I can't summarize my affiliation, so this is what I'm trying to say. The photographs, I don't say that they are only influenced by miniatures. So they are both depicting a local reality. So in this respect, of course, a local or vernacular reality or body language, if it was in place in Karagöz, then it is highly natural that we see the prints of it on the photographs and the characters of miniature and Karagöz. There is already an affiliation. There is already a similarity. But I have not studied them per se because there is this difference. Karagöz has movement. It was designed, meant to be active, because they're the dolls. They're the puppets on the table. And in the photograph, in the pose, it is very difficult to capture that. But, it makes perfect sense what you have just mentioned. I think the human silhouette, the human body, and human behaviors, as well as emotions, so on and so forth, are expressed in every form of visual material, and they are highly, very probably, parts of that continuum and related with one another, of course. Thank you. Well, if there are no other questions, thank you. Thank you very much. Ethem Bey, you said that there is a soft transition in the West from picture to photography, but that was not the case in photography in the Ottoman Empire. And I understand that you're not agreeing with that. There was a Sheikhul Islam example. Do you think that could be accepted as a proof? How does that acceptance happen? Because after all, we have the art of miniature, you know, the silhouettes reflecting that. What would you like to say about that? Thank you. Okay. Well, when I said that, I don't agree with that. I was trying to say that this is not the only way to read that. Of course, it is possible to see that disconnection. You know, something, the norms borrowed and forms and shapes borrowed from Europe and the poses which were structured upon that. And then we have a disconnection from what's not existing in reality. That's a fact. But this is not the only way to read that, to interpret that. And on the contrary, the people, especially the higher class, you know, when you go from top to bottom, where there are the European norms, rather than the norms, people were really, you know, getting accustomed to using their bodies in, you know, on the photographs. So we sort of have this photography which was constructing that, and that was connected. Of course, it is very natural that this is connected with a picture habit, because that's the same form which was seen in the miniature. Hence, that transition from, you know, Capodaldo and so forth, from miniature to the picture. When you look at the latter one, this is contrary to the European tradition. I've shown you the Renaissance elbow in the portraits, which was reflected in the photography. So in the European norms, it's a sort of vice versa. We have the Ottoman training and education, and the portraits, the painting portraits were taken and they were constructed upon the photography. So it's a sort of reverse. The most frequently used one, Abdulaziz, you know, the oil paintings of Abdulaziz, was actually based on an Abdullahian brothers photography, which was frequently seen. So paintings from photographs. You know, we had many artists who were doing so. And of course, it is confirming what Dishon said. There was this disconnection because of, you know, there was no pictorial tradition. They were taking photography. Upon that, they were creating the language of painting. But it was all about, you know, I was saying that it's not all about to say, if you go downwards, more interesting, more challenging, more tricky, and more real things could be seen. Thank you.
Bey, keşke geçmeseydiniz oraya. Size tekrar bir sorum olacak. Türkiye'de çok yaygın.
One last question for you. There is this friends, groups of friends who are posing. They place their hands, arms over the shoulders of one another. Was it because the people were not fitting into the frame, or where do they come from? I don't know. It might be. Actually, I'm rather new in this subject. So, you know, I was fed up with the Sabah photographs. So what could be the more vernacular, more real, so to say? That was my approach. And this is what I captured. And this was my interpretation of the things. Well, when, you know, I prefer to look back rather than look forward. So what could be seen in Turkey now, or what could be seen in 1930s or 40s, there was this Europeanization attempt, so and so forth, independent from the Ottoman Empire. There were many influences, actually, which could have possibly come. Sometimes it becomes risky to make that direct correlation. But if you if you look at my first contact with photography, while I was constructing the exhibition of the Ottoman Bank, and there were 6,000 photographs of the civil servants over there. It was sort of an entertainment, you know. If I was to exhibit, you know, as a fan, I made a compilation, exhibited them, and you know, Jews and Armenian Greeks, rather than do those groupings, you know, I categorize them into their postures. See, and he's inaudible. I can't hear him. Sorry. I'm sorry. He has to move to the microphone. So, there are different possible readings. But as I told you before, especially for the future, when you do that towards the future, it becomes even more challenging. So we have to be very careful because it's very risky. Whatever you would like to read, you can find it. That's the thing. Because first of all, because of that, you have to first look back, starting from 1840s. Along with the photography, some traditions are overlapping or not. Whether they're overlapping or not, is there any vernacular aspect or not? That was my priority, as a matter of fact. And in the future, of course, we can check those. But your particular question, the friends, you know, putting the, you know, holding hands or whatever. We have many forms of posing. And I think we have to check. Yes, I don't know. Thank you so much.
This is the last
Soru artık, lütfen. I'm so sorry we are diving into too many details, but I think I need to ask this question. The design and undesigned, when we categorize those, I think that's where the real problem is, because what is depiction, what is design, we can't know about those. And two, there are, you know, this hybridity where two poses are used at the same time. Hybridity is perhaps in place, right? Well, this is my thing when I said that I'm not a photography historian. I'm talking about, I'm interested in those who are photographed, where you gaze. You know, of course, that agency aspect. I still couldn't find a Turkish verb for that. That agency is what I'm interested in. How much can we define that? And of course, there is always a photograph studio, the commissioner, the person who will look at and see the photograph, and the person photograph. There's a very highly complex relationship between among those. What I'm interested, purely interested in, not designing or not designing or spontaneity. I'm not interested in that. I'm not sure whether there is any spontaneity. All of them are staged. All of them are designed. But to a certain extent, trying to understand who is more emphasized, who is more active, more, you know, more agency. You know, this is what I'm interested in. Therefore, Ali Suavi, you know, that self-fashioning, Steven Rainblatt uses that for the Renaissance self-fashioning. Put yourself onto the stage or make the others, enable the others to stage you. So moving from a number of examples, I saw that photographer is more active, whereas the person, people posing are more inactive, or the sitter, likewise, you know, vice versa, the sitter is more prominent. This is what I'm interested in, personally. So there is no full or, you know, there are fuzzy boundaries. It's sort of a slippery ground, and you can't always draw the line between white and black. So thank you.
Dear friends, it is obvious that the subject is extremely interesting. We promise you to have very soon another session on this subject, and especially for the uses of photography in history, in historiography, writing history. Thank you again. Thank you.